إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن صار على نهجه واستنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين أما بعد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. We begin as always with the praise of Allah Azza wa Jal. We praise Him, we seek His help, and we ask His forgiveness. Whoever Allah Azza wa Jal guides, there is none that can misguide him. And whoever Allah Azza wa Jal misguides, there is none that can guide him. And I bear witness that there is no God that deserves to be worshipped except Allah Azza wa Jal alone and with no partner. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the slave of Allah and his messenger. May the peace and blessings of Allah Azza wa Jal be upon him and his family and his companions and all those who follow them until the last day. O you who believe, fear Allah as he deserves to be feared and do not die except as Muslims. O mankind, fear your Lord who created you from a single soul and created from it its mate and created from them both many men and women. And fear Allah through whom you demand your mutual rights. Indeed, Allah is ever watchful over you. O you who believe, fear Allah and speak a word that is true. He will correct your deeds and forgive your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has indeed achieved the great success. And to continue, the best speech is the book of Allah, and the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the worst of things in this religion are the newly invented matters, and all of those newly invented matters are innovation, and all innovation is misguidance, and all misguidance is in the hellfire. We are approaching the most blessed days of the year, the days about which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا مِنْ أَيَّامٍ الْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحُ فِيهَا أَحَبُّ إِلَى اللَّهِ min hadhihi al-ayyam. There is no set of days in which good deeds are more beloved to Allah than these days, meaning the days of the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. These days which are approaching in only a few days' time. In these days, every single good deed that we do is more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than any other time. But there is one particular ibadah which takes place during these days, which is the focal point of these days of Dhul-Hijjah. And that is the act of worship which relates or revolves around the actions of the Hajj. And the actions of the Hajj have a number of lessons that we can benefit from and we can learn from and we can implement in our lives. Even if we ourselves are not going to make Hajj this year, or not all of us are going to make Hajj this year, there are many, many lessons in the things that we see during the Hajj that we can implement in our lives today. The first is that Hajj is all about achieving or declaring the oneness of Allah and following the prophets and the messengers alayhim as-salatu was-salam. Allah Azza wa Jal said, Al-Hajju ashhurun ma'lumat. فَمَنْ فَرَضَ فِيهِنَّ الْحَجَّ فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ وَمَا تَفْعَلُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ يَعْلَمْهُ اللَّهِ وَتَزَوَّدُوا فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى وَاتَّقُونِ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Hajj takes place in certain known months, or setting out for Hajj takes place in certain known months. So whoever has taken it upon themselves to perform the Hajj, then there is no ill speech and there is no disobedience and there is no argumentation during the Hajj. And whatever good you do, Allah certainly knows about it. And whatever you prepare for your journey, the best thing that you can prepare is at-taqwa. The best zad, the best provision you can take with you on any journey is at-taqwa. So have taqwa of me, as Allah Azza wa Jalla says, have taqwa of me, O people of understanding. And a taqwa, it is to act in obedience to Allah and to leave disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is one of the major purposes of the Hajj. Reflect upon the talbiyah that the Muslims say, labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik, إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ وَالنِّعْمَةَ لَكَ وَالْمُلْكِ لَا شَرِيكَ لَكَ. During the days of the Hajj until the day of Eid, the Muslims are saying these words over and over again, affirming that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one, that nobody has the right to be worshipped but Him, answering the call of Allah Azza wa Jal, and following the manasik, the rituals that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam showed them. And this is an obligation for every Muslim. It's not only for the people in the time of Hajj. We need to make sure that our actions are sincere for Allah alone, just like the Hujjaj are saying, Labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik. When they are saying that there is no blessing, there is no dominion, there is no virtue except from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that all of their worship is for Allah, that their Hajj is for Allah, and they are repeating this over and over again, we also need to remember this lesson in our lives. Because we cannot get our deeds accepted, and we cannot get the pleasure of Allah and His reward unless we make our deeds for Allah alone, and unless we make them in accordance with the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And just like He told us in Hajj, خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ, take your rituals in Hajj from me, then likewise we need to take all of our acts of worship from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوا وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. Whatever the Messenger of Allah gives you, take it, and whatever He tells you to keep away from, abstain from it. From the lessons of the Hajj is that, or is the goal of unity of the Muslims and the strength of the Muslims when they come together. But this unity is not unrestricted. It's not without restrictions. It is unity upon the Book of Allah and upon the Sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there cannot be any unity based on anything other than this. As Allah Azza wa Jal told us, لَوْ أَنْفَقْتَ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مَا أَلَّفْتَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِهِمْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ أَلَّفَ بَيْنَهُمْ. If you spent everything on the earth in gold, you would not be able to make these people's hearts come together. But Allah made them come together. And so when the Muslims come together on the day of Arafat, and they stand all together on a single plane with a single purpose, this shows us the unity of Islam. They stand regardless of race, regardless of color, regardless of wealth, regardless of status, in the same place doing the same things. And this tells us the importance of unity and the strength of the Muslims when they come together upon the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal. And that is the thing which should bring them together. As Allah Azza wa Jal said, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. Come together upon the rope of Allah, all of you together, and do not be divided. From the benefits that we learn from the Hajj is the brotherhood of the Muslims. And this is emphasized during the days of Hajj, and the differences between the Muslims in the days of Hajj are hidden. All help each other. Sometimes you see beautiful things during the Hajj. You see people helping other people, and those people maybe don't even speak the same language as the people they are helping. Maybe they don't even come from the same place and they don't even understand it, but they're just trying to do something to help their brothers and their sisters to perform their ibadat. They're cooperating upon good. تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Help each other to do good and to keep away from haram, and don't help each other to disobey Allah, and don't help each other to transgress the limits. This is a lesson we all need in our lives. We need to implement this in our own lives. We need to implement this, that we help each other to do good, and we help each other to achieve our goals, which are permissible, beneficial things. And we don't help each other to do haram. And we don't help each other to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us the example of the Muslims in the love they have for one another and the mercy they have for one another and the connection that they have with one another. مَثَلُ الْجَسَدِ الْوَاحِدِ. Like the example of a single body. If one part of the body is suffering, then the entire body remains awake with fever and cannot sleep. So we need to implement this in our lives as we see the people in the Hajj implementing this. From the lessons that we learn from the Hajj is that the ihram reminds us of the grave and it reminds us of death. When we wrap ourselves in two white sheets, when we take the ihram, and we wrap ourselves in two white sheets, all of the men wearing the same kind of sheets, it reminds when we take the dead body and we wrap it up in these white sheets and we put it into the grave, and it has nothing except the deeds that it has put forward. So when we see the people performing the Hajj, we should remember this. We should remember what will happen to us one day, that perhaps we performed the Hajj already and perhaps some of us haven't performed it yet. But there will come a day to every single one of us when we're going to be wrapped up in those white sheets. Not to perform the Hajj, but to be put into the ground. And on that day, your deeds cease. When the son of Adam dies, all of your deeds cease except three. You don't have a chance to earn more deeds except for the charity that is continuous, the knowledge you have left, and the children that you have left behind you that make dua for you. You don't have anything else. Your deeds have ceased. And so this is an important reminder. But there is a difference between the people who are performing the Hajj and the people who are being buried, even if they are wearing the same cloth. And that is that those people who are performing the Hajj, they still have a chance to repent. And likewise, we still have a chance to repent. I remember that somebody sent me a message recently about someone who was suffering from a terminal illness and was a very short distance away from death. The doctors told them, you don't have very long left to live. You don't have very long left to live. But even that person, even if they have 10 minutes left to live, they have 10 minutes to repent. They have 10 minutes to change. They have 10 minutes to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we see the people dressing in the ihram, it reminds us of death, but it reminds us that we still have a chance. That we can still make tawbah. That we can still turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unlike that one who has been buried in the grave and their chance for tawbah has ceased. Hajj in general reminds us of the day of resurrection. Do you not see how the people move in crowds from one place to another, like the people will move in crowds on the day of resurrection? How the people stand on a single plane, like the people will stand on a single plane on the day of resurrection. As Allah Azza wa Jal told us, يَوْمَ يَخْرُجُونَ مِنَ الْأَجْدَاثِ سِرَاعًا كَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَى نُصُبِ يُوفِضُونَ. The day when they will come out of the graves rushing as though racing towards a goal. When we see the people moving from place to place, from Mina to Arafah, from Arafah to Muzdalifah, from Muzdalifah to Mina, from Mina to Makkah, it reminds us of the people moving from place to place on the day of judgment. And when you see right now the weather is hot during the Hajj, and you see the people sweating, and you see the people struggling to go from place to place, just imagine how the people are going to suffer on the day of judgment when the sun is brought a mile's distance from the people. And some of them will be muzzled in their own sweat. It reminds us of death. And this is why in Surah Al-Hajj, at the beginning of Surah Al-Hajj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the coming of the hour. So the surah that is related to Hajj, it begins with a reminder about the day of resurrection. Ya ayyuhan nas, ittaqu rabbakum, inna zalzalata as-sa'ati shay'un 'azim. Yawma tarawnaha tadhharu kullu murdi'atin 'amma arda'at, wa tad'u kullu dhati hamlin hamlaha, wa taran nasa sukara wa ma hum bisukara, walakinna 'adhaballahi shadid. O mankind, fear your Lord. Indeed, the shaking, the earthquake of the hour will be something severe. On the day when you will see every woman who is feeding her child, that she will leave the child that she is feeding. And every pregnant woman will miscarry her baby. And you will see the people as though they are drunk, but they are not drunk. Rather, the punishment of Allah is severe. These are some of the lessons that we can take from the Hajj and we can implement in our own lives. And we have some more to mention in the second part of the khutbah. بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى أَقُولُ مَا تَسْمَعُونَ وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ ذَنْبٍ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ يَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله وحده وأصلي وأسلم على من لا نبي بعده وعلى آله وأصحابه. أما بعد, so we begin again with the praise of Allah and by sending peace and blessings and salutations upon our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and upon his family and his companions. From the lessons that we can learn and implement in our own lives in the Hajj is the lesson of being different from the mushrikeen. I'm sure all of us know that the Hajj was not something that began with our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in fact, the Hajj was something that the Quraysh, the people of Quraysh did prior to Islam, and indeed the prophets and the messengers alayhimu salatu wasalam before them. But if we look at how Quraysh used to perform the Hajj, Quraysh, they would not leave the boundary of Makkah. They would not go to Arafah. And they would say, we are the noble people of Makkah. We are the noble tribe of Makkah. We are not going to leave the boundary of Makkah to go to Arafah, out of their pride and their arrogance. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed the Hajj and he showed the Muslims how to perform the Hajj, even though he was from Quraysh, from the best of Quraysh, he still went out to Arafat. And he did things differently to the way that they did them. And that is why Allah Azza wa Jal revealed, ثُمَّ أَفِيضُوا مِنْ حَيْثُ أَفَاضَ النَّاسِ. Then go and continue on your journey from where the people move from. Go and move from the place that the people move from. And from this we take the lesson of being different from the mushrikeen, being different from the non-Muslims. The Prophet ﷺ said, مَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Whoever resembles a people is one of them. We as Muslims need to be different. We need to build a Muslim identity. We need to behave in a way that is different. Our manners are different. Our values are different. Our religion is different. Our worship is different. Even the way that we spend our time and our leisure is different from the way that the non-Muslims do. We need to be different from them. That doesn't mean that we don't treat them well. That doesn't mean that we can't be kind. That doesn't mean that we can't tell them the beauty of Islam. But we ourselves need to be different from them and not to resemble them and not to copy them. And so when we see the Hajj, we see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't do Hajj the way that the mushrikeen did Hajj. He did things differently. And that is one of the lessons that we can take from the Hajj. From the lessons that we can take from the Hajj is that the Hajj teaches patience and obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And patience is of three types. Patience in obeying Allah. And patience in leaving disobedience to Allah. And patience in what Allah Azza wa Jal decrees for you. And for those of you who have made the Hajj, you can identify with all of these three things. So you can identify how you were patient in doing what Allah told you. How you went from place to place, even though you didn't want to, even though you were tired, even though you were sick, you still went to the relevant places. You still did the rituals. You still threw the stones. You still came and you did the actions of the day of the Eid. You still did your tawaf, even though your feet were hurting. You continue to do the good things, even though it was hard. And that's what we have to do in our lives. Even though it's hard to come for Fajr, and it's hard to be in the masjid, it's hard to come for Isha, it's hard to obey Allah, it's hard to keep your income halal. There's a lot of things that are difficult to do. But just like how in the Hajj you put up with it for the sake of completing this ibadah for Allah, likewise, you also need to be patient in obeying Allah in your life, in your daily life. And patience in avoiding disobedience to Allah. Didn't Allah Azza wa Jal say, فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ. There is no rafath. And rafath has two meanings. Either it means intimacy or it means foul language. And there is no fusuq. There is no disobedience and defiance. And there is no jidal. There is no arguing in Hajj. For those of you who made the Hajj, how many times somebody pushed you? And in your normal life, what would you have done? You would have pushed them back. You would have said something, you would have raised your voice. But in the Hajj, you kept quiet. And you remained patient, avoiding disobeying Allah, because you don't want to lose the reward of the Hajj. So you avoided doing the haram for those days because you didn't want to ruin your opportunity to get the reward. And you avoided arguing with people. And the sins that you were doing, how many brothers we saw, they go to Hajj, normally they smoke. During the whole of the days of the Hajj, they don't smoke. They say, not during the Hajj. Any other time is different, but not during the Hajj. So they are patient in leaving disobedience to Allah. And likewise, in your life, you need to be patient in leaving disobedience to Allah. Because your soul craves sometimes the things that are bad for you. Sometimes your soul wants what's not good for you. So you have to be patient in staying away from those things that you know that they are haram. And how many times in the Hajj do things go wrong? How many times your hotel is not what you thought it would be? The place is not there, the bus broke down, the train isn't working. And you are patient in what Allah decreed for you. And you said, قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ وَمَا شَاءَ فَعَلْ. It's the decree of Allah and He does what He wants. And you remain patient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of the fact that you wanted that reward and you saw the reward that it had. So likewise in your own life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to put things in your path which are going to be difficult for you, and hardships and troubles and problems and tests and trials. And you have to be patient in the face of those. إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Indeed, though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards the patient with a reward that doesn't have any accountability in it. It doesn't have any limit to it. And from the lessons of the Hajj is that the Hajj is a new start and an opportunity to earn Jannah. And you too can have a new start in your life. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man hajja falam yarfuth wa lam yafsuq raja'a ka yawmi waladathu ummuh." The person who makes Hajj and he doesn't use that foul speech, and he doesn't commit open sins, he returns like the day that his mother gave birth to him. And you yourself have that opportunity. You yourself in your daily life can return back to the way that you were when your mother gave birth to you. By turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance, by turning over a new leaf and by starting a new page for yourself. And that also leads us to the fact that the Hajj builds character. It builds Muslim manners, Muslim morals. We learn how to behave with people when people are not nice towards us. We learn how to be patient. We learn how to speak in the right way, to behave in the right way, to carry ourselves in the right way. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Al-umratu ila al-umrati kaffaratun lima baynahuma wal hajjul mabrur laysa lahu jazaa'un illa al-jannah." Between an umrah and an umrah is an expiation for the sins you did in between. And the accepted Hajj, it doesn't have any reward except Jannah. So it reminds us of the virtue of heading towards, of the goal that we're heading towards. These people are there doing all of these actions because they want Jannah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They want forgiveness. And we too can go and work for Jannah, and we too can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for His forgiveness. So we ask Allah Azza wa Jal, Al-Hayy Al-Qayyum, to bless us with the knowledge of these lessons and to give us the ability to act upon them. ثُمَّ صَلُّوا وَسَلِّمُوا رَعَاكُمُ اللَّهِ عَلَى مُحَمَّدِ بْنِ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ كَمَا أَمَرَكُمْ بِذَلِكَ رَبُّكُمْ فَقَالَ قَوْلًا كَرِيمًا إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه وآلائه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقيموا الصلاة.